Welcome to the Resilient Retail Game Plan, a podcast for anyone wanting to start, grow, or scale a profitable creative product business with me, Catherine Eardley. The Resilient Retail Game Plan is a podcast dedicated to one thing, breaking down the concepts and tools that I've gathered from 20 years in the retail industry and showing you how you can use them in your business. This is the real nuts and bolts of running a successful product business, broken down in an easy, accessible way. This is not a podcast about learning how to make your business look good. It's the tools and techniques that will make you and your business feel good, confidently plan, launch, and manage your products, and feel in control of your sales numbers and cash flow to help you build a resilient retail business. What lies ahead in 2022? That is the question that is on everybody's minds as we barrel towards the end of the year. This episode's going out at the end of December, so I hope if you are listening, then you are past the last postal date. If you have an online store, maybe you're getting to relax a bit. If you are listening to this and you have a bricks and mortar store, then I know you've got a couple of really hectic days ahead. So I hope they go well. But what I wanted to do in this episode is dig into the retail trends for 2022. This work is coming off the back of the research I've been pulling together for my work as a Forbes contributor, and it is based on the vast amount of research that I get emailed pretty much every day. I'm getting pitched stories and information about what's happening in the retail industry. That's what I want to do today, is pull it into four key themes and explain what they mean for you as well as for the wider retail industry in 2022. If you're new to the podcast, my name is Catherine Eardley. I am your host as well as the founder of the Resilient Retail Club, which is my membership for product businesses. You can find out more at resilientretailclub.com. And if you use the code 10podcast, that's 10podcast, you can get £10 off your first month as a member. I'd also like to point out that I had a talk earlier this week at the end of December 2021, which was all about what's ahead for 2022, called Grow Your Sales in 2022. And although you've missed the live event, if you want to sign up for the replay, you can go to resilientretailclub.com/grow2022 and you can watch the talk as well. I had lots of great questions all about this topic. So do check it out if this is something that you're interested in. In a lot of ways, 2021 has felt harder than 2020. I think many people would agree with that. Obviously, everybody's individual, but the overwhelming sense that I've had this year has been one of fatigue, people trying to juggle the effects of the pandemic on their personal life, on their business, as well as having to pivot and re-pivot and pivot again. So it's fair to say that 2021 is going to be a year that a lot of people are going to be happy to put into their rearview mirror. Also, we have to talk about Omicron, because at the moment, the numbers are just going up and up. So what has happened really effectively is in the summer, it felt like things were definitely moving forward and moving back to some sort of normality. We have once again ended the year in the key winter illness season, if you like, with this spectre of the variant, and not necessarily sure what impact that's going to have as we go into the next year. So I'd say, first off, whenever we're talking about 2022, well, when we talk about the last 2 years, really, the key thing here is uncertainty. It's very hard to call it. And I think that's what's made 2021 so difficult, was that in 2020, actually, a lot of people saw a really big boost with people being locked down, the furlough scheme running, people perhaps having a little bit more disposable income. And that made them make some assumptions about 2020, where was it going to go? And has not necessarily come true. Now, several people have still had really strong growth in 2021. Really, at the end of the day, the key characteristic of the retail industry in general at the moment is this high degree of uncertainty. So everything that I'm going to be talking about really in terms of these trends kind of comes with a big caveat. I think these trends that I'm going to be talking about will have impact overall on the industry. They'll reshape the industry and reshape the way that the customer's interacting with it. But in terms of actual sales volumes, how the customer's going to be reacting. I think it's going to be a tough one to call. And my advice, probably always my advice, to be honest, is to be conservative, to have an idea of what you think you might take, what you could take, and then pitch somewhere you just feel comfortable with, that you're not going for very bullish numbers. I'm not convinced that, unless you've seen rapid growth throughout 2020 and into 2021, I'm not convinced that 2022 is really going to be the year for you to be bullish. So what is going to be impacting the retail industry then as we move forward into the new year? So I've split this into four key themes that are reshaping the retail industry in 2022. Is the customer wants businesses to do better. I think this is a global theme, because actually I started off talking about sustainability. I started off saying the customer, the conscious consumer, that I feel like I've been talking about now for about 4 years, which is a customer that wants to see businesses doing better, perhaps buy less, but buy better. That customer, I think we've almost gone beyond sustainability. I don't think it's just about people want to see eco-friendly options. What it all boils down to is effectively customers want businesses to be doing better. And that can mean lots of different things, from environmental concerns to better representation of the products that are sold. So, for example, for Forbes, I wrote a piece in November about representation in greetings cards, in Christmas decorations. I talked to people like March Muses, who are the leading black Christmas decoration manufacturer in the UK. People want to see inclusive spaces. They want to see it reflecting diversity of the world around them. And I think going forward into 2022, that's just going to continue growing as a movement. It almost goes beyond a trend to a movement. The environmental impact is definitely not taking a back seat. And we obviously had a huge focus on that in 2021. And I think looking forward, customers are going to be more demanding than ever. For the research that I was doing for Forbes, I had commentary from Chris Biggs, who's the global head of retail for the Boston Consulting Group. And their research showed that 90% of consumers are more concerned about sustainability than ever before. They said in the UK, 41% of Brits wanted recyclable choices and sustainable packaging, and that definitely influences their buying decisions. 70% of them were willing to pay a price premium of around 5%. So not a huge price premium, but a price premium of around 5% for sustainable products. So 70% of the people they surveyed. So there's a huge proportion. Customers really want to have the eco-friendly option, and they want to see that businesses are making sustainability a real priority. However, I think that it's important to recognize that while customers want businesses to do better, the customer is also getting a little bit more cynical. The Chartered Institute of Marketing did a really interesting study all about the perception of consumers around sustainability claims. And 63% of the people they surveyed said that they would like brands to be more vocal about their sustainability plans, but they remain skeptical about the authenticity. So effectively, there is a growing perception that sustainability can be used as a marketing tool as opposed to a real something that's built into the business. There's this theory about radical transparency. So for Earth Day earlier in the year, I did a piece about independent fashion brands who were grouping together to really push the agenda on green and sustainability issues in the fashion supply chain. And they called for this radical transparency, which is effectively being really, really open about what you're doing. And I think especially when you look at the impact of big fashion chains claiming that they have a conscious range or a organic cotton range, while at the same time there being serious questions raised around the people in their supply chain and how they're treated, you can definitely see where the customer's cynicism perhaps comes from. So it's always worth remembering as a small business that customers are not only watching, they want to see you doing better, but they also may be a little bit suspicious. So what can you do to prove that any claims you make, whether it's about diversity and inclusion, whether it's about sustainability, what can you do to really show that this goes beyond just a marketing ploy? Part of this move towards doing good, or businesses that are doing better, is the whole movement towards the circular economy. The circular economy, or the idea of reusing items, reducing the amount that goes into landfill, and generally reducing the usage of virgin materials, which, as we know, are a dwindling resource. That is all really moving to the forefront. And there's a lot of research into resale. So resale is effectively, in fashion terms especially, it's slightly different from, say, charitable donations, because it's a more curated market. So people pulling together fashion items, for example, accessories, reselling them. This is growing at 11 times the rate of traditional clothing retail and is set to double to $77 billion by 2025, which would make it far bigger than the fast fashion industry. We're seeing players making moves all over the industry to purchase resale businesses. So, for example, Etsy purchased Depop, and Farfetch, the luxury fashion online brand, recently purchased a resale business as well. It's happening all over the industry. So resale is really growing, and I think it's spreading as well. It works particularly well in fashion because obviously fashion items are reasonably durable. You can pack them up, ship them off. They're not going to get damaged necessarily. And they're also higher value, so it makes it worthwhile to resell them. But we are seeing reselling shifting into other product areas as well, from electronics to furniture. Lots of opportunities for people to be reselling items. Basically, secondhand has completely lost its stigma, and people are really seeing this as a great opportunity to not only get something at a good price, but also to do it in an environmentally friendly way, which means that you're not creating more items that could ultimately end up in landfill. What does this mean for small businesses? Well, for small businesses, is there an element of circularity you can build into your business? Some businesses can, some businesses can't. Can you make your own products more circular? Is there an opportunity to buy things back in return for a credit? What can you do to think about your business becoming more circular? And if nothing else, really, just thinking about this whole idea of the customer wants you to be doing better, having another look at your business. Are you really clear about what you're doing? Are you really clear about why you're doing it? And are you communicating those efforts to your customers as we move into 2022? What else is on your wish list in terms of doing better with your business? Is it a charitable donation from your sales? Is it looking at your supply chain and seeing if you can work with more sustainable suppliers? Is it about organizing something for awareness? Is it about education? So where you're looking to educate your customer around some of these issues they may not be aware of. What is it in your business? But just know that as we move into 2022, the customer is looking for businesses to do good and will be receptive to hearing about it. So the second big trend is really all about social commerce. So we know that 2020 and 2021 has been a huge acceleration forward for online shopping. You don't need me to tell you that. We've read about it. We've heard about it a huge amount. But one of the people who I heard from for the trend report was Amir Kabara. He's the director of product for Shopify. Shopify are really a fascinating company, and a lot of people listening to this podcast will have Shopify as their platform for selling. But they're really a global technology company, and they're an interesting one to watch. If you want to know where the e-commerce industry is going, they obviously are really keeping their eye on that. And they're a great business to watch in terms of where they think it's going to be going next. So Amir Kabara, his view was, his quote is, 2022 is the year that we'll see the social commerce model, which is deeply embedded commerce that meets consumers where they are and is non-disruptive to their experience, spread to more platforms and more industries. So what does that mean? So social commerce is effectively where you can buy through your social media platform. And any platform with an audience is what Kabara says. So anybody who's got an audience, he thinks will start to see more and more monetizing that platform through commerce and shoppable content. So another way of putting it is really about the line between shopping and entertainment blurring. One of the big trends behind this is live streaming. Live streaming is just everywhere. Everything that I read about the retail industry, about e-commerce in particular, it all goes back to live streaming. Live streaming is where somebody is talking to camera. It's effectively like think QVC, think the Shopping Channel. It's about somebody selling. And Meanwhile, people can purchase directly from the live stream. TikTok is a great platform for this, obviously, because it's all about video. And Shopify teamed up with TikTok to make it so that merchants, people selling through Shopify websites, could actually go live on TikTok and be selling their products. So this live streaming as part of social commerce, as part of monetizing your audience, is popping up everywhere. So you've got Twitter launching live stream platform, Pinterest, Instagram, TikTok. All of the social media platforms are trying to get in on a piece of this because the whole market is projected to reach nearly $224 billion by 2028. In China, it's already huge. So a huge proportion, I think it's about a third of all e-commerce sales in China are happening via live streaming, which, if you think about it, it's absolutely crazy. And it's definitely picking up and is something that is getting bigger and bigger. So in the UK, in the US, for example, during Black Friday, Walmart were doing a whole series of live streams, I think through the Twitter platform. And then Amazon were also doing loads and loads of live streams with people like Miranda Kerr and getting celebrities in basically to talk about their products. From August to October 2021, installs for live selling apps on the Shopify platform increased by 40% compared to the previous 3 months. So this technology is really taking off, and I think it's something to really think about as a small business. Ultimately, you just need your phone, you need yourself. Why not go for it? There's no reason at all, especially if you're someone who's got yourself comfortable talking on camera, why not think about it? And there's a lot of research that suggests it's not just about the selling, it's a great way to connect with consumers. And it's, again, that line between shopping and entertainment. So what's ahead for e-commerce after it's asserted its world domination with more and more people buying online? It's social commerce. So it's people buying through platforms, in particular, people buying via live video. So if there was ever a time to get yourself prepared to talk on video, this is it, because there's certainly going to be a growing number of consumers who want to see the products being demonstrated. It's actually a fabulous opportunity to really replicate the experience of seeing something in person. You can really talk it through and go over the details of the item and entice people to buy. So it may sound terrifying, but I really think this is a huge opportunity for a lot of small businesses because the barriers to entry are low. You don't have to have a whole studio or a production suite. You can do it from your phone. Why not give it a go and see what happens? The third big trend then is all about hybrid retail. So what is hybrid retail? Well, we've had the whole debate between online and offline. You've probably heard the word omnichannel as well. Omnichannel being selling across multiple channels. But hybrid retail is effectively a recognition of the fact that they tend to have a customer journey that crosses from maybe research online to maybe looking at something in the shop to online again to offline. So looking at the two things separately, a store versus a website, is actually less helpful as we move into 2022. So hybrid retail is effectively making better use of the opportunity provided by the internet to complement their physical store. That was a quote from Andrew Goodacre, who's the CEO of the British Independent Retailers Association, BIRA. So BIRA is saying that they've seen more and more smaller retailers developing hybrid models. And again, it's just a recognition of the trend that if you've got a physical space, you've got to really think about how your online complements that and vice versa. Steve Dennis, who's a phenomenal retail commentator based in the States, he has this theory that a lot of the things that we call e-commerce actually involve a store at some point. So whether that's buy online, pick up in store, BOPIS, or click and collect, whether it is buying online, return in store, BORIS, whether it is purchasing an item online, but it's actually being fulfilled from a store, whether it's using the stores as mini distribution centers like Argos do. Argos have a very sophisticated system of almost satellite stores working as mini warehouses. So a lot of these things that we consider e-commerce actually do involve a store. So again, thinking about the two of them separately is not very helpful. And then also thinking about how technology can facilitate that journey. One of my favorite software companies, I don't know if that's the right way of putting it, one of the ones I find the most interesting is a company called Near Street. And what the company has done is made stores inventory searchable online. So if you search for a black dress, it won't just show you the Next website or the ASOS website. It will also say 10 minutes walk away, there's a boutique and they've got black dresses, for example. They did some trials in London where they were boosting Google ads. So if somebody was searching for jewellery, that they were boosting an ad that would point them to the direction of a local shop that had jewellery. And they saw some great, incredible results. Increased footfall, increased spend. So lots and lots of proof that online shopping, that people will start their journey online, but they may not end it there. We talk about saving the high street. I think this is one of the most compelling ways to do so, because what you're doing is you're making it easier for the customer. You're making it more environmentally friendly because you're not then ordering a package that's going to get put in a van and driven around to a million different houses before they come to your house. You're talking about people going to their local shops, but knowing what's there and being able to purchase the items and take them home. They're also able to see things before they buy them, maybe even try before they buy. And it's just a better experience for customers. And I think that if we want people to shop locally, we've got to keep giving them those really useful, easy, seamless opportunities to buy, because that's what will keep them coming back. Hybrid retail is going to be really key. Anyone listening with a physical store, it's thinking about your online presence, what you can really do to maximize that. So is it, for example, something where you could even be able to access a customer's online sales history to offer in-store discounts? Could a sales associate in a store be able to see a customer's order history so they can make personalized recommendations, for example? And if people can't come into the store for whatever reason, could you do live video in-store shopping appointments, for example? So it's thinking about all the different ways that you can leverage your in-store staff, your in-store environment, and making it as seamless an experience as possible for your customers to cross between online and offline. There's also an idea that eventually going online to check the inventory first before you go out to a shop is going to be as common as checking the opening times. And I think that would be welcomed by a lot of customers. A lot of research during the pandemic that people have started doing even more research online before they go to a physical space, because people are really thinking twice before they travel. So anything around making it really clear what's in your store before people even leave the house is only going to help. The final trend that I wanted to talk about in today's episode is all about loyalty. You may have noticed, if you're somebody who runs social media ads, that there has been a lot of chat in this space in the last year or so, especially since the iOS 14 updates came in, which meant that there were changes to the way that ads were tracked and attribution of sales from advertising. The cost of acquisition, the cost of acquiring new customers, has been something that has been talked about for a long time, especially in the e-commerce space, is something that people have to really watch out for. And I think in 2022, that is going to really be hammered home more than ever, with people focusing not so much on obtaining new customers as really working with their existing customers and building that loyalty. So I think loyalty as a frontier for growth will be a key theme in 2022, whether that's focusing on reputation management. So this is all about managing your reviews, building up a really good bank of user-generated content and testimonials from your customers. That's going to be a really big piece of it. But then also things like the number of different payment options. So buy now, pay later, BNPL, from the likes of people like Klarna, has become a really interesting theme in the retail industry. It's almost like a bit of a battleground over customers wanting to have these different options when it comes to payment, spreading out their payments. But then also this slight pushback from consumer advocates saying that buy now, pay later is not really any better than a traditional credit card in terms of working with people on problematic spending. So it's a little bit of a controversial one. But regardless of whether or not you're offering buy now, pay later, having a variety of different payment methods is key to building customer loyalty and giving your customers what they want. 2022 is just going to be more of the same, thinking very much about what your customer wants and how you can offer it to them. Part of this as well, this whole idea of loyalty, is the idea of local creating loyalty. There's been a lot of statistics of how people are shopping more locally. So, for example, Near Street, who track the number of people searching for stock in local physical stores, said that went up 4 times in the pandemic, 4 times as many people looking for items in their local stores. And that hasn't really come down since then. So there's a lot to be hoped that people will be thinking, both big retailers and small retailers will be thinking about ways that they can engage their local community to help drive loyalty, as well as just offering more of what the customer wants, whether that's payment options or the ability to read other people's opinions of products and services before they purchase them. Finally, then, looking ahead into 2022, we've talked about the importance of doing good. We've talked about the growth of social commerce, talked about how it's no longer online versus offline, but all about the hybrid, and also how people need to be focusing on loyalty as the new frontier for growth, as opposed to looking to constantly be bringing in more and more new customers. But one of the prevailing themes I think we'll see in 2022 is a continued sense of disruption. We've had a lot of issues with supply chain disruption due to COVID, due to giant tankers stuck in the Suez Canal, or due to Brexit. And this could continue into 2022. So consumers are aware and they're becoming more used to disruptions. And they are also probably getting more cautious with their spending. So one of the things I always talk about with your customers is it's almost like they've got their money and they're holding it tight in their hand, and your job as a business is to get them to open up their hand and give you their money. What we're seeing during times when consumers are more cautious is that it's just going to take that bit of an extra effort to get them to open up and to give you their money. So how do you deal with that? Well, in the same way that you deal with anything when you're trying to grow your business, you think really, really carefully about what it is that your customer needs. And you talk to them about in a way that will persuade them that what you have, or you create things, really. It's not about persuasion as much as it is about having the things that people want and the things that people need. And that's what's going to steer you right as you move into 2022. Be aware that there is a lot of research suggesting that consumer spending will be even more cautious than previous years. So you're going to have to convince people that eat that bit harder as the value of what it is that you sell. And one of the best ways to do that is to really be focused in on giving them what they need. So there's a lot going on. It can feel a little bit overwhelming, but I would really encourage you to spend some time thinking about what's ahead for 2022, thinking about where the opportunities are for your business. And if you want to come join us, then we are running a 5-day challenge at the end of January. This will be the third year I'm running it. It's called Plan Your Year 2022. It's always such a fantastic opportunity to get together with other business owners and to talk about what's ahead, what your plans are for your business. If you go to resilientretailclub.com/plan2022, then you are going to be able to sign up. It's completely free, and you will be very welcome to join us. We will be getting into so much more detail about what's ahead, what this means for small businesses, and what you can do to start off 2022 on the right foot. So do come and join us in the 5-day challenge. But in the meantime, why not have a think about some of these things? Think about how you can drive loyalty. Think about how you can offer your customer more of what they want. Think about your social commerce opportunities, what you could do with that and what that might look like for you and for your business. If you have a physical space, think about hybrid. Think about if there's anything else that you can do in that space or anything else that you can tap into. And think about your values. Think about what you're doing well as a small business, what you're trying to do, the change that you're trying to make in the world, and make sure that you are telling your customers about that, because going into 2022, it's going to be all about values and it's going to be all about value. So you're going to think about how you communicate your beliefs to your customer, as well as how you persuade them that buying from you is the right choice. I hope you have a wonderful break if you're not already on break, and we'll be back next week with a review of the year. If you've enjoyed the podcast this year, then please do take a second to rate and review. It makes such a difference, and I read all of the reviews personally. Do also hit subscribe and you'll be the first to know about every new episode. If you've enjoyed this week's episode, then I invite you to check out resilientretailclub.com. The Resilient Retail Club is the membership for anyone wanting to start, grow, or scale a profitable product business. No more trawling Google trying to find the answers to your questions or wading through general business advice that speaks mainly to service-based businesses. Whether you're still at the idea stage or you've been going for a while but want to get more focused and organized when it comes to your business, the Resilient Retail Club is the place for you. With a library of courses tailored to creative product businesses, several live sessions a month, and a supportive and active community, the Resilient Retail Club is the perfect membership to help you hit your goals faster. Check it out at resilientretailclub.com.